Welcome to a public radio partnership of KCRW and KPCC LAist. I'm Steve Chiotakis. This is a series of virtual events that we call Meet the Candidates, and I'm glad you're with us this evening. We are here coming to you from the Annenberg Performance Studio at KCRW headquarters in Santa Monica, in beautiful Santa Monica, California. Again, I'm Steve Chiotakis, host of Greater LA on KCRW. And today we're talking to one of the people seeking to represent the 3rd District of the LA County Board of Supervisors. This covers a massive area, all the way from Malibu to Santa Monica, all the way from West Hollywood up to Porter Ranch, Calabasas, Agoura Hills, and other areas of the San Fernando Valley. There's a primary election that's set for June 7th, and then the general election beyond that is set for November the 8th. These virtual events are part of coverage made possible by support from the Committee for Greater LA in partnership with the Conrad N. Hilton Foundation and also the Weingart Foundation as well. So we thank them for their, indeed for their support for this programming that we've had for you this week. We have received questions for the candidates from listeners ahead of the event. We invite you to ask your own questions as well. If you're watching this live online, you could submit your questions through the Q&A function on the left side of your screen. I think that's left for you. Live captioning is also, it is on the right side of your screen, the left side to me. That's what I should say. So look at the Q&A function as you're checking this out. Live captioning is also available as well. And we're going to get started. Our guest tonight is State Senator Bob Hertzberg. He is the California State Senate Majority Leader Emeritus, and he's represented the 18th District in the San Fernando Valley since the year 2014. He served in the Assembly between 1996 and 2002, was Speaker in his final term. He ran for LA Mayor back in 2005. But finished 3rd in the primary behind Antonio Villaraigosa and James Hahn. He was born in LA. He is 67 years old. Senator Hertzberg, welcome to you.
Thanks. It's good to be here. Really appreciate
it. Nice to have you here. As I mentioned, you have a long career in Sacramento. Going back to 1996, you served as Speaker of the Assembly.
I did.
Majority Leader of the State Senate. You're often described to a lot of folks as a political moderate. How would you describe your track record? You a centrist?
I don't know what that means. What I do is I work to build consensus. I have deep respect for people that get elected. Not everybody gets elected from communities that look like me or have the same political views. I think we have an ethical obligation to find common ground and to figure out and to move things forward. People get frustrated when government's not working, when people sit on the sidelines and scream at each other and nothing happens. I don't know what that means. I've taken tough positions on issues of immigration and bail reform on one side, and the other side I've taken other positions, so I don't know how you define yourself. I don't like those characteristics. The book I was going to talk to you about here, I talk about different kinds of people, and that I call it the Hey Not So Fast Party, people that are moving and you're trying to make decisions and you don't know what the heck's going on. Does it help you or hurt you? So, you know, I try to make stuff happen and work on core issues that affect people's lives.
Let's talk a little bit about the district that you want to represent. This was just redrawn, as you know, to include some more conservative-leaning areas of the San Fernando Valley alongside the more liberal coastal areas, right? So we're talking Santa Monica, but it also goes inland toward Agoura Hills and other places, too. You've basically said that you've only decided to run because redistricting brought in so much of the valley. Is that true?
I wouldn't say it's only because. It's a reason for it, because the San Fernando Valley, first of all, the district before was Democrat plus 40. It's now Democrat plus 38. I would suggest, as you do the diagnostic, beyond what the spin was and what happened with a nonpartisan redistricting commission, that it really isn't that much different in terms of where the politics are of the district. The idea of the San Fernando Valley having 63% of the community was very important to me. I've represented the Valley for a long time and with a break in between doing renewable energy, but it's a community that doesn't feel like it gets represented, and particularly at the County Board of Supervisors, the current incumbent, I've seen her once. I talked to people in the city of San Fernando or Pacoima, says she won't go there, it's too far. I talked to people in West Hollywood, we come once a year. So I'm a kind of person in politics that shows up. I go to neighborhood councils, and I think it's really important to show respect to voters. So I think the county needs a voice that has a big piece of the valley. But the last thing I will share is I delivered like big time for the Valley. Why? Because I fight for the people I fight for. Let me tell you, if I represented Fresno, their streets would be paved with gold. And I know there's that larger argument in terms of other areas of the communities that are represented, these 47 communities that are part of this supervisorial area. But it was a factor. It was absolutely a factor. We need a voice.
Have you been their voice? You've been their voice, obviously, in the state legislature over the course of years. What have you delivered to them in your time there? What can you look the people in the San Fernando Valley and say, this is what I've done for you?
Well, I built the Orange Line. I mean, I literally was in the governor's office when he walks in, and my first day as speaker, I walk in, he's talking to a staffer about $265 million for the Crenshaw Line, and I say, well, where's the $265 million for the Valley? He goes, oh, we can do that. And I pick up the phone, and I call Zev, and I call Howard, and we put in the Orange Line, and we were going to do the one going up the center of Van Nuys, $226 million worth of sound walls, a performing arts center at Cal State Northridge, hundreds of millions of dollars for Cal State Northridge and the Valley College, 38 new campuses for schools throughout the San Fernando Valley. It's a long list, whether it's trees or last year, $5.7 million for Jewish Family Services for the homeless, another $25 million for an ethnic studies center for Northridge. My job is to deliver for the community, and I've worked my guts out to do that.
This is I would say a different kind of job, though, right? Wouldn't you admit? I mean, from someone in the assembly in the state senate in Sacramento to somebody who's representing the county?
I don't think so. I think that the basic there's certain elements of the management side that are different in terms of the relationship with departments. But a lot of the elements to be an advocate for your community is critically important. I was in a situation where the students at CSUN, California State University Northridge, were having a hard time getting to school, three or four buses. And this Metropolitan Transportation Board would not provide for transportation. I went to war to fight for those folks, took out a full-page ad in the newspaper, hundreds of thousands of emails, and got $180 million for a dedicated busway to get kids to school from the Northeast to the Northwest. And all the community people were upset. You know, when you look at what Mark Ridley Thomas did in his days in South LA, when you look at all the different sections of the community, no, I think a big piece of what you do, you have a large vision of what the vision of the county is, but you deliver for the people that vote for you. I think that's core to who we are as representatives.
I want to invite a community member who submitted a question to our candidate. This is Joshua Fine. Joshua.
Good evening, Senator.
Yes. Hi.
Hello there. Would you support efforts in the state legislature giving counties the ability to appoint rather than elect their sheriffs?
100%. You know, let me tell you, I've been around the sheriff's office for a long time. My father was a lawyer with Pete Pitches, which was way back in the Wayback Machine. I knew Sherm Block pretty well. And I chaired Lee Baca's campaign four times. Dear friend of mine. I know he got in trouble, but I'm old school loyal. I watched that office a lot. I watched the fights about term limits. I watched the fights with the Colts Commission and all these various things. And I think that we need a model similar to the model that we have in the city of Los Angeles, where you have like a police commission and they appoint the person. I think this idea of having an elected sheriff has a whole host of personalities. Problematic issues. And so I think that we're at a point, especially given the challenge that we've been facing recently on HR issues and all these other challenges, I think the harmony between the Board of Supervisors, commission, and the county would be very important. And I would absolutely support that. And I think it's the right thing to do.
Thank you, Joshua. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Josh.
Let's talk more about the sheriff, who is up for re-election, by the way, Alex Villanueva. His department faces allegations of civil rights violations, misconduct, financial mismanagement, deputy gangs that are alleged, a record of clashing with the board. You've seen this before as well. Yeah. How do you deal with these issues should Sheriff Villanueva be re-elected? And do you think there's a better candidate for the job?
I'm not endorsing in the race. I was a big Jim McDonald candidate person. I really liked him and supported him strongly and thought he did a great job. I've only met this sheriff twice, one time sitting next to him at a swearing-in of a super senator, and one time at a political event he was at a park that I worked on in the San Fernando Valley. And I don't know him, but I certainly don't like what I read and what I hear. But the question is this: How do you manage something like that? What's been happening is it's back and forth and it's screaming and it's press conferences and it's finger pointing. I'd go sit in with him. I'd go to his office. Don't come to the eighth floor and act like you're a prima donna. Just go meet with him and see if I can find common ground. Now, maybe I can't. I don't know. See if there's a way. But my experience is when you engage in this behavior, it escalates and it just puts people in their corners. There's got to be a way to figure that out. And I don't know if I could do it. I'm not suggesting I could make magic. But I'm telling you, that's how you build relationships. When Arnold Schwarzenegger got elected governor, I told him to go meet every labor union, you know, and the Republicans on the staff said I was crazy and was stupid. I said, I'm not telling you to agree to anything. Just go introduce yourself. Build a relationship. Maybe you have a chance. And that's what I would try to do.
The county is committed to a care first, jails last policy, which
Correct.
Is something that we've talked about on this series for the past week. This includes closing Men's Central Jail, replacing it with housing and supportive services. Now there are activists who say the transition is happening way too slowly for something like that. So I want to ask you a couple of questions about that. There are thousands who, with serious mental illness in Men's Central. Do you support moving people with mental illness out of the jails? And if so, how do you accelerate the process of finding housing and providing services?
First question, yes, absolutely. 66% of the people, not just the Men's Central Jail, but in the jail system are women. 40% are men who have mental health challenges. Big problem. You have to separate the two. You also have people who are pretrial detainees. You have to take them out of the jails. You also have juveniles. You have to take them out of the jails. So I've been to Men's Central Jail. I'm a lawyer for a lot of years. I remember in the old days, I represented wrongly accused people who were in that jail. All my clients were wrongly accused. And and so the point is that, yeah, I would right now, it was what, 2 years ago, we said we would have a plan. 10 years ago, there was another plan. We've been talking about it, talking about
it. It's a $2 billion plan to put one where in the Antelope Valley.
So, yeah, you have, well, not about that, but look, that's one of the reasons why I'm running. Here's the challenge. In the state legislature, we're writing checks for billions of bucks, billions of dollars, and we send it local, and the implementation is not good. Right? We're taking people, juveniles, taking people out of jail. When they go to jail and we're putting them on, they go right on the streets. Why don't we have a program for that? The people in the county came to me and asked for $2 billion a year or so ago. And I said, here's the deal. I'll give it to you. But like when I go to Blockbuster and I buy a camera and it don't work, I bring it, I get my money back. Will you guys send your money back if it doesn't work?
Because I don't think you're going to Blockbuster to find a camera, but.
I have done that in the past, by the way, but it was a long time ago. But the point is, it's the best example I could think of on the spot. So my point is that it's all about implementation. People say the devil's in the details. The devil is in the details when you don't do the homework. When you do the homework, God is in the details because it works. It works. And so when I look at the county and I looked at these issues of how, like, for example, we deal with the rent eviction and 36-page application, when I look at so many of the kinds of challenges that we're facing and the delays and the like, this is what incentivizes me from moving to be the policymaker on the big stuff that writes these gigantic checks. And when I go to neighborhood councils, they scream at me, what have you done? Well, we gave you the money, and the public's giving you the money. They've written the checks, they've done bonds, and stuff's not happening. So the implementation, this is one of the many examples. And I would do everything I can through CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act, and other things to expedite this. But the basic frame is, A, shut it down. B, I will tell you that there are places for jails. I am not someone that says there's no thing. You have a violent offender, you have people, we need jails. That doesn't mean we need 4,000 beds like we have in Men's Central. I don't know what that number is. I wouldn't speculate because I'm not knowledgeable enough to know. But I'm telling you, I wouldn't get rid of them. But there's a lot of people, whether it's mental health or pretrial detention, that don't need to be there.
Where do you put a jail? Are there many locations for it? What happened to the $2 billion plan?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't have to know the answer to that question. I generally know the talking points, but I'm not a talking points person. I'm a guy who writes books.
Yeah.
Which I want to talk about.
Well, this is an Oprah. This is, we're talking.
I know, but yeah, nothing's for sale. Nothing's for sale.
I do want to talk about a recent county report that found that reducing bail to zero for many people who were arrested during the pandemic had basically no impact on rearrest rates. You've been involved with efforts at bail reform,
correct? I have.
So would you continue this emergency bail schedule that's currently in place?
Well, look, first of all, let me tell you. The thing that I did, I spent 6 years of my life working on this. I had private investigators and lawsuits and people running against me and my car tracking devices and stuff because the bail industry was so angry that I was trying to take them down. And I was. And the reason I was doing it wasn't because basically my framework was if somebody is a public safety risk or a flight risk, they should be held. But if there's somebody who didn't have a big enough wallet to get out because and their life was turned upside down, it was unfair and unjust. And so you shouldn't determine that. The zero bail schedule was set by the Supreme Court and the Judicial Council because it was COVID. And there was huge rampant infections that were going through the jails. That was something that's done locally by those determinations. I don't think the zero bail works. I don't think that that's something that we that really, I mean, certain counties are doing it, but the idea of having a bail schedule based upon the person's ability to pay is what we should have.
We're talking to State Senator Bob Hertzberg, who's running for the 3rd District of the LA County Board of Supervisors, and we do have another audience question as well from another community member who submitted a question to ask the candidate, Lynn Miller. Step up to the microphone. Thank you.
Hello, Lynn Miller.
Hello, Mr. Hertzberg. Thank you for running, and thanks to KCRW for allowing community questions. The current 3rd District Supervisor, I would say, has done a lot of managing issues on the margins. For example, replacing policemen who are tending to homeless people with mental health workers, but yet not having enough mental health facilities to send them to.
That's right.
So what specific skills and accomplishments can you tell us about that will let us know that you will get things done that are significant impacts in the 3rd District?
Yeah, that's a good question. To me, it's not about issuing these ordinances or these motions that ask people to do studies. It's doing the homework, man. It's doing the homework. It means sitting with each department head and finding out if it's real instead of sitting there on the 8th floor and having staff draft these things up. It's really dealing in to make sure that they work. So let's take a look at the homeless issue in terms of what's going on in the mental health. So now you've got some a naked person on the corner of 3rd and Brendo, what do you do? Well, in July, we know we're going to have a 988 system that basically mirrors and lays on top of the existing system. That's quite challenging, okay? So you need to really drill into that to find out if we have the capacity when someone dials the phone number, is someone really going to answer? Second, the question is, who shows up? Well, there's a couple of different ways who show up. First, in March 22nd, just a few days ago, the county finally issued an $18 million pilot project for these mobile psychiatric folks to show up. There's only like 33 of them. The LAPD has, I think, I don't know how many there are, I think there's 14 units of those things. It's called the SMART unit. I just met with the police chief and talked to him about this. And people don't work on the weekends and they don't work the evenings, and it doesn't make sense. So, and you also have a really, and I apologize for the details, but it is, God is in the details. You have a significant problem between public health that has certain budget revenues and mental health that has other budget revenues that are flexible dollars to pay for this stuff. So that whole system is upside down. So it requires, to give you confidence, for me to go have those meetings, to meet with my colleagues, to drill in with the CEO of the county and get into the details to figure out how we get the allocation of those dollars. If it means I got to go to Sacramento to get additional dollars, there's been a bunch of money that I worked on with Jackie Lacey to do that. You make that happen. Then the third thing is, once you pick them up, because you don't have somebody with a badge and handcuffs to pick them up, where do you take them? Well, there's been a number of these units that are out there, but there are only 16 people per unit under the federal laws, under the 1115 waiver that we'd have to ask for. I would organize like crazy to get that done. And you know, even in the state hospitals, there's like a 6-month to 14-month wait into the terms of getting in the state hospitals. So it requires people who are the executives to not just have an idea and throw it out there, but to understand, does it really work? Will it be impactful? Can you make it happen? If you make a promise, will you deliver? And the reason I'm running is because that has not been happening, whether it's the jails, whether it's the mental health issues. Example after example I could give you for 2 hours. You know, the knock on me is that I've got a zillion ideas, and if you give me enough time, I'll flesh them all out. And that's a true statement, because I think about this stuff. I don't go to sporting events. I don't know anything about sports. This is my life, and it takes this level of education and dedication to figure this complexity out.
Not even a Dodgers game?
Once in a while, but very rarely. Yeah. I probably maybe once in the last 4 years.
All right. No sporting events?
Well, I went to Clippers with Steve Ballmer once. I've been to my first game. I went to one Laker game. But I'm not.
We're just clarifying.
Yeah, you can clarify. That's fair.
All right. I want to talk about homelessness, what Lynn was talking about. You mentioned the 988 system that's supposedly coming, right?
July.
At some point in July. We here cover housing and homelessness at KCRW, and some of the big trends, or at least one of them, has been embracing housing first.
Correct.
Creating permanent supportive housing before you use law enforcement then to move people off the streets. Do you support forcibly removing encampments before there are enough housing units for those folks?
Not unless there's the Supreme Court case, Boise case, says you can't do that. So I wouldn't want to get embroiled in litigation. But, you know,
the Boise case was
you have to have
facility. Beds.
Right, you have to have beds. So the idea is if there was no beds, you couldn't do it. If there was beds, I support the idea what the governor's doing, which I think's really smart, about these care courts, where you can take people in care courts. You can do 5150 or 5250 holds. You then take them into the care courts. You can then take them through the law, through the process of conservatorship. And then the other thing that I want to propose as part of my plan is to be able to have enough judges. I used to work years ago when I was chair of public safety in the assembly on drug courts. Care courts are similar, but you need to train judges now to get them to understand how to work these care courts. It's not a typical court. It's really a mental health facility that has an overlay of the law and how it works with conservatorship and the Lanterman and Petra Short Act.
It still sounds, though, very piecemeal, right? Like, it's not a panacea. It's not going to solve the issue. We keep talking about it, and this is another audience question, by the way, that's being asked, but what's the number of units of housing that you would be happy to see built in District 3 over, say, the next term, should you win?
Enough to take care of everybody. That's what I'd like to do.
Is there money for that?
Well, yeah, sure there's money. Let me break it down for you, simple, okay? Let's look at the issue. There's kind of a couple of tranches. One are people who are just down on their luck, who don't have money, who get stuck on the street. Well, one out of seven people who work for Kroger's are homeless. They don't have homes because they don't have to make enough money to pay for that stuff. You have people who have covenants in their affordable housing that those covenants are expiring. Protect the covenants, okay, and do what you can to make sure those people don't go on the street. They don't have substance abuse or mental health issues.
This is a safety net.
Safety net. Okay, that's kind of the one frame. The second frame is the mental health piece and what you do there and how many people you get off the street. And I just think what the idea is, you've got to make progress as quick as possible to show confidence. I personally would settle the lawsuit immediately. I think it's a mistake that the county isn't participating in the city. It's another example of the city and the county not working together. That's horrible in terms of solving this problem. I would settle that lawsuit as fast as I could. And in terms of units, how do you make those units? Where do you create them? You ask, where do you put them? Well, let's come up with some creative ideas. I'll give you a couple. And then I want to talk more broadly about housing. Because you got housing and homelessness, and part of it's affordable housing, and part of it's just the not enough production. Okay? So we have all the surplus land. I have a bunch of interns in my office. I had them go out and survey all the government land in the valley, over 3,000 parcels. Basically, the bottom line, took it to the state. They said there's 18 that work. They only have two in the state when you looked at the legislative analyst's report.
Government land, though. Explain that.
These are government land where the government owns the dirt. And the question is, can you...
Which government? Like the state of California?
It could be the state. It could be the city. It could be the county. It's owned by taxpayers is the bottom line. That's the determination. So the question is, how do you declare something to be surplus so you can use it for housing? Well, when you get into the morass of blah, blah in bureaucracy, blah, blah, it's a special part of the government code, it says you got to go through this whole process to declare it to be surplus. How about this idea? How about this idea? And I just talked to the head of real estate for the state. What if we buy the land at the state? We're spending all this money anyway. Let's buy the land from the city or from the county or whatever it is. Give them credit for their housing. And guess what happens when the state owns the land? We bypass a lot of the local regulations. We did, and I work with Miguel Santiago for the city, and I want to do it for the county, for these affordable housing units to exempt CEQA. Now, all of a sudden, you don't have all the local regulations. You don't have CEQA. State owns it. What does the state do? Leases it back to developers for $1 a year. Why is it so expensive to have any kind of transitional or affordable housing? Because there's four things when you build something: the cost of the land, the administrative and financing costs, the building costs, and the labor cost. If you can make the land $1 a year, all of a sudden there's a whole big opportunity there. And we talked about this, and it's extraordinary, but I think it's got to be a pilot project in Los Angeles, because the one thing I learned about being speaker for the state, when you're trying to get votes, I got to figure out how this works in Fresno or Imperial County or Del Norte County. If I do a special project for LA, everybody says, fine, that's your problem. I'm happy to vote for the bill. So the state is so important because counties are subdivisions of the state. And I apologize to sound too wonky, but God's in the details. I will never walk away from that. And you've got to know how that infrastructure works and how to make stuff happen if you're going to actually do something beyond platitudes. And I say, put me to the test, because that's what I've done. And I'm full of ideas and stuff that I want to do to actually make the county work.
One idea that's from Governor Newsom, who signed a law last fall, allows for what, up to four homes to be built on single-family lots?
That's correct.
Supporters say that it would create more affordable housing, would help ease the housing crunch. You have opposed this effort, though. Would you continue to oppose it as supervisor? I mean, wouldn't you agree that one of the drivers of homelessness, as you just mentioned, is the fact that there's a lack of affordable housing?
Well, let me tell you this. First, I opposed SB 50, which was 14 units. Second, on a single-family home in a single-family neighborhood. Second, I opposed SB 10, was 14 units based with the discretion. I did vote for, unlike my opponent, I did vote for the SB 9, which is the lot split with two and two, right? I don't think that that's the solution in terms of the last element I want to talk to, which is production of housing, what's called adaptive reuse. Downtown Los Angeles using commercial buildings that people aren't using anymore, turn them into residential. ADUs, granny flats, unbelievably successful. I think over 10,000 in the San Fernando Valley since it started a couple years ago.
These are garages, right?
Garages or whatever, but they work and they're easy to work and they fill up and it's a really big deal rather than lot splits and all the mishigas that you got to deal with. And so that's a good Greek term. So in any event, the point is there's a lot of avenues and I don't want to destroy single family neighborhoods, but I did support SB 9.
What do you think is the biggest thing that hinders the solving of this crisis?
Well, when you say this crisis,
is it money? Is it
will? No, I don't
will?
Think it's money.
Is it
homeless crisis is one. I mean, the whole thing about mental health and substance abuse. And then the other piece is production, okay? So I've been working for the last year and a half on one of my other big ideas on a $25 billion bond issue, which is investor money, not taxpayer dollar money, to be able to have home ownership. I believe, and in my book here, which is my transcript of the book that I wanted to share with you called Course Correction, Chapter 10, it says, the name of the title is, It's Time to Restore the Social Contract for California. And Chapter 10 says, home is where the wealth is. You cannot keep building rental units. Rental units after 10 years, all you got is a bigger rent bill. You got to give chance for people to build equity. You got to give young people a chance to get a piece of the rock. So we're going to give down payments on homes. We're going to only apply to new homes, so it has to be for construction. You're not buying your grandma's house. It's only new construction as an incentive to build new housing. So you're dealing with the people who are at homes about to lose them. You're dealing with the transitional piece of people that have challenges for mental or substance abuse. And then you're dealing with the missing middle to provide a future for folks, to give them hope and to give them an opportunity to have equity in the system. Because what's happening now, and that's the premise of my book, is the rich-poor divide is killing us. The rich are getting richer, the poor are getting poorer. It's exacerbating on the internet, and people are going to their corners, and we've got to give people hope. We've got to deal with the student loan crisis, which I talk about in my book. We've got to talk about how to finance stuff without just wealth taxes. And so I'm kind of trying to be creative and invent the future. And if it doesn't work, okay, fine. Course correct. Come up with a new way.
You've been
in the game.
You've been in politics, though, in Sacramento for 25, 26 years now.
No.
How
I was
long?
In politics for 6 years. I left government for 12 years. I traveled the world because when I was speaker, they had an energy crisis. And I was so impacted by the energy crisis. And I was so tired of people talking about it. And I'd go to all these people and say, how many pounds of carbon did you reduce in the environment? So I went to South LA. I started a solar company. Sold that company. Went to Cardiff, Wales. Started another company. Went to London. Worked on electric cars and wind and Africa and Sri Lanka and India. I won the World Bank Award for a project in Rwanda. Listed as 50 people to save the planet because of all my work around the world. And I came back because I saw we were still in the space. We're spending money on regulations and attorney's fees and not really reducing carbon in the atmosphere. And I saw great opportunities. That's why I just went to Reykjavik this week to go look at carbon capture out of the air. Creative, inventive ways. And that ties into my final point, which is what we need to do. If we're going to electrify and turn this place green, and we're going to say we're going to have more electric cars and this and that, we got to be making transformers that are 20,000 volts instead of 4,000 volts. What's that supply chain look like? Let's create those jobs here. We want to do green energy, green hydrogen. Let's create the electrolyzers here. Let's create real jobs for workers that make real money and invent that industry here that bolsters the economy and stands behind from an economic perspective the policy perspective we talk about. Because right now, all this stuff we're talking about is pie in the damn sky. We can't do it unless we do the homework and do the details.
Speaking of which, we talk about Aliso Canyon. This is the largest methane gas blowout in U.S. history. It happened, how many years ago? Governor Newsom pledged to shut it down. how many years ago, but instead, the use of the gas storage facility has actually increased. Do you support shutting it down?
And yes.
When?
I'm not smart enough to answer that question. I'm not dodging it because I'm not going to just give you platitudes. That's not what I do. I know who I am. I'm comfortable in my skin. I'm not inventing stuff to just say it. It's got to shut down at an appropriate time that works. It's got to, you know, I want to use green hydrogen instead of natural gas. The first bill that my opponent did when he was there, I was a joint author. And what I do as a leader is I help other people. It was his district. I let him be the cheeso on it. I help work the details behind the scenes to make sure it passed. I've been on every one of these efforts to try to help. But we've got to be smart about it. And I don't know the answer to that question. I honestly don't. I would tell you if I did. But it should be as fast as we possibly can to make it work.
What about Santa Susana, the field lab?
Well, that has been a disaster for 20-some years. When I was Speaker, I was dealing with that crap and all the cleanup with Department of Energy and all that stuff.
Yeah, it's been going on for decades.
Decades. Unbelievable. It's unbelievable. I tried to work with some of the advocates on that a couple of years ago to figure out a way to turn it into a big park where we could expedite the cleanup, get some money from Boeing and the other people to build trails, you know. And in a bipartisan manner, I wanted to call it the Ronald Reagan Great Park because that's where he shot his Western movies, and I figured I'd get Republican support.
Did you get any? No?
Didn't work.
No.
But I tried. You know, I had a vision for it, and you try.
How do you make that a park?
Well, if you look at it,
I mean, don't you have to get rid of the radioactive waste?
Yeah, it has to be cleaned up. It has to be cleaned up. It has to be cleaned up. There's no question about it. But surrounding it, you've got, you know, the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy. There's about 6 or 7 big conservancies around it. It's literally, if you looked at a map, which I had on my wall, it's really kind of fantastic. And when it kind of reveals that this really is a great place for a park. But yes, you have to clean it up. But the idea is to create a vision around it, to expedite it, and then try to get some contribution from these corporate entities to be able to put the trails. The problem with parks is not money, because I've done a bunch of big park bonds to buy them. It's maintaining them that's hard.
I want to ask some listener questions. This is what we've gotten from the web, from people who are watching on our stream. How would you respond to the very vocal group of people who oppose construction of more public transit and accompanying dense housing in their neighborhoods?
We've been doing it. My sense is when you look at that, all the bills that we've been doing, all the construction, there's over 10,000 units along the Orange Line for transit-oriented development. All the bonuses for development have been worked. And we really haven't had, unless I'm in the dark here, places you can share with me, I'd appreciate it. But where I represent in the San Fernando Valley, people are celebrating the Orange Line. Its ridership is 3 times the numbers. And the same thing with respect to the development. We really don't have a significant problem within the transit-oriented development areas. The problems that you're talking about that I've perceived are the neighborhoods where people feel like
these are
going to destroy their neighborhoods.
Supposed NIMBYs or whatever the people
know. I know people argue that, but what the big issue there was LA is a grid city. So the argument that was being made in those other bills that I opposed was a half a mile from a bus line. Well, if you have a grid city in my area, for example, I live near Victory and Van Owen. Well, it's less than half a mile between the two. So if there's a bus running on each one, it means the entire neighborhoods are affected. So we change those things along major corridors, around rail routes and stuff, and we're able to get reasonable support with not a lot of backlash. But the real framework is folks are upset about destroying their neighborhoods. They work all their lives. They're worried about the value of their homes and the like. But I just feel, and I've certainly experienced it, you know, near my house, there's a 2,100-acre park, Sepulveda Basin, right? All along Victory, for those listeners who see that, there's all this land.
Woodley and all of that near Sepulveda. Yeah.
All that, exactly.
Yeah.
You can take a piece of that. And, you know, part of it's a flood zone because when I was a kid, I rode horses at Art Kinley Stables, and we used to ride. There was no freeway then. You know, that's how old I am. And we used to ride into the...
That's the natural part of the LA River, right? That's the one that actually looks like a river.
That's absolutely. It's really cool. So you build stuff on stilts. You figure it out. It's not that hard. I just think it's political will, and there's no real objection to doing those things. I've talked to so many neighborhood folks that there's opportunities to build. I mean, we're not looking about building 30 million houses. You're talking about building, you know, 100,000. It's in the scheme of things, there's a lot of places where that can happen. It just takes a little creativity and imagination. I was just in West Hollywood, and there's 13 acres in the corner of San Vicente and Santa Monica that's owned by the county. Why can't we turn that into a community of a bunch of housing and mixed use and things
affordable
like that.
Housing.
Affordable. Oh, you'll have to have a portion of it affordable, but you got to make the economics work.
Is the portion enough? Is the 8% important?
No, I mean, it's hard. It's a fair question. It's hard. You know, you're trying to balance this stuff out, but then the question is how much the affordability is tax dollars, right? We're going to pay for it out of the general fund. When you deal with the general fund, everybody says, do this. Well, the education people say, I want money for education, or the foster kids want money for this. And how do you balance all that stuff in a way that you don't tax people to death? It's hard. And, you know, one of the things that I think I bring to the table, I lived through tough times. I lived through downturns. You know what it's like when you've got furloughs and cut budget cuts? Right now, we don't have enough Brinks trucks to bring all the money we have in California. It's easy to govern during times where you got a ton of dough, but that's money.
Dough.
So
for the kids.
For the kids.
Yeah.
For the kids.
Bread. We also say bread sometimes.
Yeah, bread.
Right?
That's right. From the hippie days. Bread. Hey, man, you got any bread? It's funny. But yeah. You just got to be creative in financing tools and a whole host of things. That's why this down payment assistance program that I'm talking about, we're going to loan people $153,000 to be, they got to put 1% down. We know from the data, you got to have a little skin in the game to 1%. And the rest, you get a new house. And you're more, and you're, instead of having at the end of 10 years a high rent bill, as I said, you'll have a mortgage payment that's the same money because we're only going to do fixed rate mortgages.
And you're building equity
You're building equity.
Yeah.
You're building equity. How do you do that?
But how do you do that with, I mean, the average, what, the median house price is $700,000-$800,000? How do you do that?
$750,000. Beyond that, it gets tough. I disagree. It's hard. The prices are high. And it doesn't mean you're going to be able to build a house and get one of these houses in Beverly Hills. But we just passed laws about row houses. I used to own a row house in Sacramento a couple of years ago where you own the land, not like a condo. Or it's going to be condos and things like that. And it'll be smaller units. But how many people bought houses for $30,000 that are worth $1 million today? You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. You know what? You got to try. You got to get in the game. You know, this HHH is going to build 10,000 houses. Fine. Don't criticize it. 10,000 houses ain't nearly close enough to what we need. What's the next step?
Well, you criticize it for how much money, how much tax money it's taking.
Of course.
That's where the criticism comes from.
Well, I know. I get that. And you're right about that. But you also have to be visionary in the sense of how do I get to the next 30,000? What does that look like? How, when you ask me the question, how many units are you going to build in the valley? I got to think that through. I can't say I'm just going to rely on HHH. I've got to think through what are those plans and where, how do you cite those and what does that look like? And what are those sources that you can put those in and how do you put stuff together and think it through and build the mechanics to make it happen? That's how you make stuff work. Details, details, focus, you know, do the homework.
You talk about the Orange Line, the bus line, right? You live where, Van Owen, or somewhere in that area?
I live on near the corner of Sepulveda and Victory.
And Victory. So is L.A. ever going to be a transit town, do you think?
No.
No. Why? It's just cars? It's too spread out? What is it?
It's a city of 284 annexations. It's a bizarre time in history how it was created. In order to build a really integrated system like you've got in New York or Philadelphia or a lot of other cities or in Europe, it requires a more compact and denseness. I think what's going to happen is, and I know I'm out on a limb on this, but I live on limbs sometimes, is that I think technology is going to change. I think the automated vehicles are going to change. I think housing policy is going to change with less garages. You use them for storage and not for cars. I think it's going to fundamentally change patterns. I personally believe in smaller communities where people don't have a need to move everywhere and the big roads are used more for goods movement. We're seeing that step now because of the pandemic where more people are working at their homes. I think this is the beginning of a fundamental shift. Offices down by 25% in terms of their usage of office space. That's why we're going to turn those into what's called adaptive reuse for housing. RAND just did a report, 72,000 to 113,000 houses, they said last week, can be developed in LA County from adaptive reuse. Bingo, right? Great idea.
That's what you're talking about in downtown LA.
That's what I'm talking about downtown LA, and you can do it all over the place. You can do it on the high rise on the corner of Ventura and Sepulveda. You know, people are moving out of those spaces, and people are using less space in their offices. They're working in bullpens. They're shrinking their office size because people are working out of homes. Let's get ahead of the curve. Let's invent the future. Let's be smart about it. I don't want to just look back. Yeah, you're right. You want to criticize some of this stuff. But that's a small piece of our energy. The big piece of our energy is inventing the future. And that's what I want to do. That's why I'm running for this job. I'm not a small ball person, and I'll make mistakes. Everybody does. But I'll own up to them, and I'll take responsibility.
Thousands of people, county employees, face losing their jobs over the employee, this is another listener question, by the way, over the employee vaccine mandate. Do you support vaccine mandates?
I think that the vaccine mandates need to be relevant to the nature of the work. I think that the problem with the county in talking to a number of the labor people is that no one's really talked to them. Nobody tried to work with them. Nobody tried to figure out, can there be a way that you can test and work around it? It was just this dictatorial top to bottom. I don't think you manage that way. I don't think you build confidence in a workforce in the public or private sector. You work with people bottom up. And there may be certain areas where it might be mandated, but I don't think it's nearly the level at which their folks talks about. And I think that it's just been a tone-deaf approach to the process. You shall do. Well, wait a second. What does that mean? Are there avenues? What do the experts say? And I think there's opportunities. But most importantly, respect the folks you work with. That the stuff I've heard from talking to county employees is number one. Work with them. Try to figure out solutions and make it work with them.
Well, if there's a mandate, though, mandate's a mandate, right?
Well, mandates don't have to be mandates. It says everybody and anybody. Mandates might be testing once a week. Mandates might be wearing masks. Mandates might be age-related. Mandate might be other health restrictions or the like, depending on who you're working with and what you're doing. I don't think that's appropriate to one size fits all. That's not how the world works, and it's not fair.
How do you think the county did with this, with the COVID pandemic?
No, I'm not a, you know.
Would you give it a grade?
No, I don't think that's right. I'm not a big believer in grades. I believe in alternative education where they don't have grades.
How do you think the county did for the pandemic?
I don't know. I'm not. I mean, I don't know. I don't want to be.
You're going to be one of five if you win the election.
Well, I know, but you're asking me a different question.
Right.
You're going to ask me how I'm going to do. It's going to be A plus. You're asking me how they've done.
It's purely subjective. But yeah.
Not subjective.
I have to say.
Yeah, I know you have to
say. You brought a book.
I brought a book.
Yeah.
I brought two books.
You did.
I don't know. I think a little bit's been over the top. I think obviously the numbers in certain respects have been good. It's hard to predict looking 2020 hindsight. I hate doing that to people. I'm not looking to stick my finger in people's eyes. But I think some of it has just been, you know, the old adage that says the charge of a captain is to protect the ship. They never leave the port. There's balances in that in terms of restaurants and businesses or Disneyland, that's Orange County, or Universal Studios, which is the communities that I represent, or others. And I think some of that stuff's been a little too harsh.
Harsh as in,
you know, it's driven by the people in the administration rather than by elected officials who's charged with exercising a different kind of judgment.
But if a life is saved, ..
Yeah, I know. Well, I mean, but the question is, you got to look at the larger factors. Is again, would you say if a life saved, would you drive a car? Would you fly in a plane? You know. I mean, it. What point does it...
Risk assessment,
of course. Yeah. You got to be reasonable in this stuff.
One more question from our audience. This is from online. You mentioned water. What immediate concrete steps will you take to lower water use?
Well, there was a series of laws that were passed in the legislature called Conservation as a Way of Life. There were two bills, one by me and one by Assemblywoman Laura Friedman. There's a second bill that's in the legislature today as a result of studies and recommendations by the State Water Resources Control Board that deals with regulations of indoor water use. I am the author on that bill. Water has been my life. I wrote my dissertation on it in 1976. I sat on many boards dealing with it. I worked with the negotiations for the Colorado River, for the lining of the All-American Canal along the Mexican border. And every year I do water. And I actually introduced a bill that said it's against the law to put water in the ocean. Now, why did I do that? Because we're stealing water from the Colorado River over our allotment. We're stealing water from the farmers up north and from environment up north. And we take the water, we clean it up to federal standards, and we put 3 million gallons of water of cleaned up water into the ocean every day. As they say in Yiddish, for all the Yiddish listeners, a lochenkop, you got to have a hole in your head. One of the things...
You're talking about sewage.
Well, it's not sewage. It's cleaned up to federal standards. And so what I want to do is to take that water, not put it in the ocean 3 miles out. I want to bring it back and recharge the groundwater. So Mother Earth that does the final percolation, and you recharge the groundwater. It deals with sustainability. We've got a drought that the LA Times says and other reports say 1,200 years. It's crazy. We've got to be smart. We passed Measure W that takes the water, cleans it up from stormwater to federal standards, puts it in the ocean. I was upset about that because I wanted to take that, pipe it, and recharge the groundwater so that, you know, we've got to have a sustainable approach. But right now, conservation as a way of life is the law. And I have a bill that passed the first committee in the Senate with the administration's folks behind it, dealing with indoor water usage and trying to reduce the standards over the next number of years to deal with that very problem. It is a very big issue. It is going to be as big as every other issue we face if we don't get aggressive on it. And I'm really focused on it.
You think desalination has a future?
No, not in this, not in a gigantic way. The brine issue for the ocean, the fish issue, the heat, and all those issues are very challenging. It does have some future in inland water for inland areas with its brinish, brackish water and stuff, but it's not by gigantic orders of magnitude. I think that there's other ways to deal with that. I think a lot of conservation is a big deal. You look at Israel, you look at other countries about how they irrigate, how they have radio frequency tags for plants that allocate the water, how we do what's called purple pipe or gray water that we use for landscaping the outdoors and along the freeways and golf courses and stuff. There's a lot of intelligent ways where you can segregate portable water. And, you know, I've done a half a dozen bills in the Central Valley. We have people having trucked in water. They don't have access to water. And these small little communities, there's something like, I don't know, hundreds of small water districts that literally don't have water. It's horrible. So I, even though it's not the communities I represent, it's part of California, and we've got to take care of it. So I'm a big water guy.
We're going to end it there. I want to thank you for coming on.
I can't talk to you about my book?
No.
Okay.
No, but that's all right. But I thank you for bringing it and putting it on the coffee table.
Working clothes.
All right. State Senator Bob Hertzberg, thank you for coming on today, running for the L.A. County Board of Supervisors, District 3. This is the seat being vacated by Sheila Kuehl. Senator, appreciate your time.
Hey, thanks.
All right. And thank you for joining us at home. We do appreciate you joining us at home. These virtual events are part of our coverage made possible by support from the Committee for Greater LA in partnership with the Conrad and Hilton Foundation and, of course, the Weingart Foundation as well. I'm Steve Chiotakis on behalf of all of us at KCRW and KPCC LAist. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening, and have a nice night.